I am teaching what I sort of taught about a week ago during the Friday night Zoom meeting. So the passage that we're working out of this evening is 1 Samuel chapter 28. It's a lengthy passage, and I'm not going to read the entire passage. We'll just sort of go through the verses and highlight some of the passages. But I'll begin reading here in 1 Samuel chapter 28, verse 3, okay? Now, Samuel was dead, and all Israel had lamented him and buried him in Ramah, even in his own city. And Saul had put away those that had familiar spirits and the wizards out of the land. And the Philistines gathered themselves together and came and pitched in Shunem. And Saul gathered all Israel together, and they pitched in Gilboa. And when Saul saw the host of the Philistines, he was afraid, and his heart greatly trembled. And when Saul inquired of the Lord answered him not, neither by dreams, nor by Urim, nor by prophets. Then said Saul unto his servants, Seek me a woman that hath a familiar spirit, that I may go to her and inquire of her. And his servants said to him, Behold, there is a woman that hath a familiar spirit at Endor. Our Heavenly Father, again, we pray that as we come to your word, especially as we examine this specific passage of Scripture, may we allow your words to instruct us. May we have quiet hearts and eager spirits, and certainly may we cut through some of the fanciful and some of the traditional ideas and just sort of grasp what it is you're communicating here in this rather peculiar event. We thank you for all you are, all that we have in Christ Jesus. And as always, may our time together this evening prove to be profitable. May it prove to enlighten, encourage, and once again, may it redound to the glory of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen. The reason I chose this passage as the topic for study is, of course, next week is Halloween, and you know what's going to happen next week. You can study the origins of Halloween. There are wonderful websites out there that'll provide a lot of the detail. And if you examine Halloween in and of itself, fundamentally, Halloween celebrates or remembers the dead, and that's really what's going on. I know modern day Halloween, everything is cute and everything is innocent and everything is harmless. But if you study its origins, it's rather disturbing. But there is this fascination with the dead. In this passage, we find Saul doing something that was strictly prohibited in Israel's history, okay? In Israel's national identity. He is going to inquire with a woman who has a familiar spirit. Again, she's not technically called a witch. We're going to look at a passage where witches and wizards and sorcerers and necromancers and those with familiar spirits are categorized together. So we're not going to get upset if, again, I refer to her as a witch. But she has a familiar spirit. So the question is, what exactly is a familiar spirit? A familiar spirit is an entity that makes a connection, a medium, if you will, that makes contact with the spiritual realm, specifically for the purpose of calling up the soul of a dead person, conjuring up the soul of a dead individual. And the reason people would inquire with those with familiar spirits is they sought to communicate with the dead in order to receive knowledge, in order to receive revelation. So in Israel's history, and as we examine the land in which Israel is occupying, there was this desire to contact the spiritual realm, the so-called underworld, okay? With that said, if you'll notice the word familiar, you see the root word family. That's kind of interesting. Historically, sadly, they had child sacrifice, and we'll see some of those verses as well. Israel was strictly prohibited from allowing their children to be sacrificed, for example, to the god Molech, okay? It's rather interesting that in connection with child sacrifice, you right away, in various passages, learn about the prohibition against dealing with witches, wizards, sorcerers, necromancers, and people with familiar spirits. So it's not out of the realm of possibility that perhaps you had parents, for example, that sought to communicate with the children that they would sacrifice. So the word familiar is again, a word we want to take note of, especially that root word family. By the way, historically, there has always been this interest in ancestor worship, in worshiping ancestry. And it is interesting historically that the Hittites, and we'll see some things about the Hittites this evening, they maintained an active line of communication with the spiritual realm. They had a deep interest in the, quote, underworld, okay? With that in mind, just drop down quickly to verse 13, okay? And the king said unto her, be not afraid, for what sawest thou? And the woman said unto Saul, I saw gods ascending out of the earth. She witnessed a phenomenon that she was not supposed to witness. When she saw gods, small g gods, ascending out of the earth, we'll find out these are fallen angels. In the scriptures, there are holy gods. God, by the way, is the God, capital G, of gods, small gods. In the Bible, you have, for example, in the book of Daniel, you have holy gods. Those are the elect angels. Those are the angels that are participating in what God is doing. And Daniel has some fascinating things about what these holy gods are doing. With that said, there is conversely other gods that are evil gods. They are false gods. So this woman sees something. And by the way, I take 1 Samuel chapter 28 as a literalist. There are different ways, and I don't have all the I's dotted and all of the T's crossed. There are two primary views on what's happening here. If you glance back up to verse 9, and the woman said unto him, behold, thou knowest what Saul hath done, how he had cut off those that have familiar spirits and the wizards out of the land. Wherefore then layest thou a snare for my life to cause me to die? And Saul sware unto her by the Lord, saying, as the Lord liveth, there shall no punishment happen to thee for this thing. Then said the woman, whom shall I bring up unto thee? And he said, bring me up Samuel. And when the woman saw Samuel, she cried with a loud voice. And the woman spake to Saul, saying, why hast thou deceived me? For thou art Saul. How do we handle this passage? Did this woman, I'll call her the witch of Endor, literally see the soul of Samuel? There are a couple of different views, all right? The two primary views are called, one, the spiritist view. Secondly, the literalist view, okay? The spiritist view, they believe that what the woman saw was a counterfeit spirit, that it wasn't really Samuel, but it was a masquerade, it was a fallen angel masquerading as Samuel. Now, by the way, a fallen angel does not have the power to call a soul up from the underworld. A fallen angel can't call up a soul from the place of torments, nor can a fallen angel call up a soul from Abraham's bosom. We'll see a couple of verses that I think are adequate in demonstrating only God has that ability to do something like that. So when you have a witch, for example, who is dealing with evil spirits, a witch deals with the devil himself, by cooperating with these evil spirits for the purpose of performing some supernatural act, okay? That's what's going on. And let me say this. Why did God prohibit activities like sorcery, necromancing, familiar spirits? He didn't prohibit it because it's impossible to make contact with the spiritual realm. He prohibits it because it is possible to make contact with the spiritual realm. So just keep that in mind. So what this individual would do by inquiring with a familiar spirit, this fallen angel masquerades as the departed one. In other words, this fallen entity, he possesses an alter identity. It's not the real soul, but rather it's the alter identity or the alter personality of the soul that someone is seeking to contact and to conjure up from the dead. Okay? With that said, there's a camp that would argue this lady did not really see Samuel, that Samuel was not literally called up from Abraham's bosom. That's the Spiritist view, that what she was witnessing is the counterfeit spirit of Samuel. And you ask, well, why is that the case? And you will hear one pretty prevailing argument: God would never use a witch. God would never use a necromancer. God would never use a wizard or a sorcerer or someone with a fallen, a familiar spirit to contact anyone. Well, that's a weak argument, I think. I think that's underwhelming, okay? The presumption is, well, God would never use a witch. What God is doing, God is not doing anything by the witch. He's doing something in spite of the witch. I take the other viewpoint, which is called the literalist view, which, as you can imagine, means what? I believe the word literally. I believe that really was Samuel. And there's a reason. See, we don't need to get all uncomfortable about this. Why would God literally call up Samuel? And I believe there's some good reasons for God doing that. We know something out of the ordinary takes place. Look at verse 12 again. And when the woman saw Samuel, she cried with a loud voice. She freaked out. She panicked. This never happened before. In other words, she's had experience dealing with familiar spirits. If she's a fake, if she's a fraud, that could very well be. She saw a supernatural event that terrified her. And hence, she screams because she never experienced this before. Her crying loudly, to me, is an indication that this is something extraordinary taking place, okay? I take the, quote, literalist viewpoint, that that is Samuel, and God does it for a specific reason, okay? Now, as we start digging a little bit into this passage, let's, at the outset, understand what's happening is foreboding. Okay, we already read, for example, verse 3, right? Verse 3, now Samuel was dead, and all Israel had lamented him and buried him in Ramah, even his own city, and Saul had put away those that had familiar spirits and the wizards out of the land. Okay, Saul, the king of Israel, he followed the commands of the Lord. He did what he was supposed to do. What business now does he have in inquiring of familiar spirit when he knows it is prohibited? We know it's prohibited. A lot of verses. Let's just go to a couple of them. Go to Leviticus chapter 20. If we go to Leviticus chapter 20, just appreciate the strong language that God issues when dealing with these individuals. Again, not because they're dabbling in the impossible, but they're messing around with the spiritual realm, and they don't have any business doing that, okay? Leviticus chapter 20, look there, beginning at verse 1. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, again, thou shalt say to the children of Israel, whosoever he be of the children of Israel, or of the strangers that sojourn in Israel, that giveth any of his seed unto Molech, he shall surely be put to death. The people of the land shall stone him with stones. And I will set my face against that man and will cut him off from among his people, because he hath given of his seed unto Molech to defile my sanctuary and to profane my name. verse 5, then I will set my face against that man and against his family and will cut him off and all that go a-whoring after him to commit whoredom with Molech from among their people. Now notice verse 6. And the soul that turneth after such as have familiar spirits and after wizards to go a-whoring after them, I will even set my face against that soul and will cut him off from among his people. Again, just notice when you read passages about sacrificing your seed or your children to Molech, right afterwards, you kill anyone who is dabbling in the spiritual realm. Why is there always this connection? Drop down to verse 27. Verse 27. And notice there, a man also or woman that hath a familiar spirit, or that is a wizard, shall surely be put to death. By the way, that witch of Endor, she wasn't put to death. But who did die? Saul. Now, I just wanted to throw that out because I know we're not going to get to a lot of this stuff. But you know what's happening with Saul? What God is going to do in 1 Samuel chapter 28. Just as the familiar spirit takes upon the altar identity and the altar persona of this dead soul, Saul is going to be taking on the altar identity and the altar persona of the witch, of the necromancer. God's going to deal with Saul in the same way Saul should have dealt with the witch, the one with the familiar spirit. So now we can begin to piece some things together here, you know. Why would God do what he's doing? So, again, verse 27, a man also or a woman that hath a familiar spirit or that is a wizard shall surely be put to death. They shall stone them with stones. Their blood shall be upon them. By the way, you know how Saul died? He fell on his sword. His blood, he's responsible for his own death, okay? Anyone who dabbles in the spiritual realm, their blood shall be upon them. They're calling the wrath of God upon themselves. Frankly, that's what happens to Saul. He's the one who falls upon his own sword, okay? Let's go back to, by the way, keep a marker in 1 Samuel 28 because we're going to be flipping, flopping back and forth, okay? And let's just, at the outset, appreciate the land area because there's something in Scripture about the spiritual activity in the area in which we find Endor, okay? And I think this is important because when this woman sees gods ascending out of the earth, the reason she sees these fallen angels active in this region of land is because there is a great deal of satanic activity in that realm, okay? In 1 Samuel chapter 28, verse 4, and the Philistines gathered themselves together and came and pitched in Shunem. And Saul and gathered all Israel together, and they pitched in Gilboa. So we have two cities, two areas, okay? Now, if you're not familiar with the Mideast region, this is the Sea of Galilee. The Dead Sea is much further south. This is the River Jordan, okay? We have Jerusalem, which is farther south. We have the Mediterranean Sea out to the west. Up to the north, you have Mount Ararat. You have modern-day Turkey, okay? Shunem is going to be the garrison of the Philistines are going to be just west of King Saul and the Israelites, okay? Shunem is right along a mountainous area. Saul and the Israelites, they're in Gilboa, okay? So what does Saul do? He asks his servants, hey, verse 7, and Saul said unto his servants, seek me a woman that hath a familiar spirit, that I may go to her and inquire of her. And his servants said unto him, behold, there is a woman that hath a familiar spirit at Endor. How did they know there was a woman with a familiar spirit at Endor? That already indicates there's a spiritual problem, okay? Why would they know? So we're going to look at Endor. Endor is a fascinating city or village. I don't care which one. Now, you got to appreciate what Saul's going to do. Saul, verse 8, and Saul disguised himself. What do kids do every Halloween? Where did they get the idea of putting a disguise on? By the way, you know why children put disguises on? Historically, 2,000 years ago, the Celts, the Druids, they went guising. They would put on costumes so that evil spirits wouldn't terrorize them. So now we have the innocent little children that exploit people going through the neighborhoods wearing costumes. Well, wait a minute. Saul, he has to wear a disguise. The king of Israel, he's hiding his identity. Now, isn't that a spiritual problem? Why would you hide who you really are? So what he does, he disguises himself, and at night, okay, again, by the way, there's all sorts of types in chapter 28. That would be a lesson all of its own, all of the different types. So what he does, he disguises himself, he puts on other raiment, and then he travels with two other guys by night. What Saul has to do, he has to evade the Philistine army. Now, Gilboa is also at a foot of a mountainous area. Again, Shunem is at a foot of a mountainous area. Endor is behind another mountainous area. Here's the point. Saul has to cross enemy lines to get to this woman. Do you see another type there? You start dabbling with the spiritual realm as someone who is called by, you're crossing enemy territory. You start dabbling in the spiritual realm. Saul, by crossing into enemy territory, he serves as a type of participation in the satanic policy of evil. He puts off his identity. He disguises himself. He's operating in the night. Isn't that all? By the way, God worked with Israel through types and shadows and figures. As an Israelite, you read this chapter and you should start realizing, what is this guy doing? So anyway, he crosses into enemy territory. He's evading the Philistine army. He has to go. He kind of snakes his way into Endor, about 6 to 8 miles. Okay? So what is it about this particular landmass? Number one, by the way, Endor. Okay, it's a Hebrew word. Oh, remember, remember the television series Bewitched? The witch's name was Samantha. Her mother's name was what? Endora. Well, the writers of that television series, they got that idea from 1 Samuel chapter 28. Why would they name this witch's mother, who is a witch? A little boy in one episode asks Endora, are you a good witch or are you a bad witch? And Endora responds, come see, come K. I hope I pronounced it properly, okay? Is that how you pronounce it? Come see, come K. It's French, which means not so good, not so bad, right? By the way, somebody sent me an article. The actress who played Endora, her name was Agnes Moorhead. She bequeathed her estate and her Christian book library to Bob Jones University. You guys know Bob Jones University. Fundamental, conservative. And you got to think, wow, how did she know about Bob Jones University? It's kind of interesting here, okay? So what is it about this particular region can we learn about? Endor is believed to be derived from a Hittite term. The Hittite term is Ena Dorena, Endor, which means ancestor gods or primeval gods. Well, that's an interesting name. But does the Bible have anything to say about this particular landmass? Before we go back in the Old Testament, let's go to Matthew chapter 4 here, okay? There is something that we can recognize in Matthew chapter 4. Now, you know this is the Lord Jesus Christ right after he's tempted in the wilderness, Matthew chapter 4. And we read there in Matthew chapter 4, verse 12, now when Jesus had heard that John was cast into prison, he departed into Galilee, and leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is upon the sea coast in the borders of Zebulun and Naphtali, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali by the way of the sea beyond Jordan, Galilee of the who? Gentiles. Just recognize something here. This territory that Saul is sneaking around in is called, in Matthew chapter 4, Galilee of the Gentiles. And it's called Galilee of the Gentiles, not because Jesus is preaching to Gentiles. You know, there's a lot of, if you read some of your, you know, the commentaries, they would argue, well, it's Galilee of the, he goes to Galilee of the Gentiles because he is now going to begin preaching to Gentiles. He does not preach to Gentiles. And how do we know that? Keep your finger here. Go to Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10, verse 5. These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, go not into the way of the who? The Gentiles. Into any city of the Samaritans enter ye not, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. You know why this territory is called Galilee of the Gentiles? Historically, this area was occupied by the idol-worshipping pagan Gentiles. And you have Israelites that are living in this Gentile-occupied region. And as a result, these Israelites began to adopt the Gentile way of commerce. They began to adopt the Gentile culture. They adopted Gentile politics. And at the same time, Israelites were hated and they were persecuted. I mean, the reason it's called Galilee of the Gentiles is because Gentiles are trespassing in God's promised land. The Gentiles aren't supposed to be there. So what Jesus does first in Matthew chapter 4, he's going to go into Galilee. By the way, remember all of the disciples except one, Judas, was from what area? Galilee. This area. So Jesus deliberately is operating. He's calling out the lost sheep of the house of Israel from out of the Gentile dominated landmass. Verse 16, the people which sat in darkness saw great light, and to them which sat in the region and shadow of death, light is sprung up. Okay? Now, drop down to verse 23. And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in the synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. And his fame went throughout all Syria, and they, by the way, that's Syria, that's the Roman province, okay, of Syria. All right. Anyway, and they brought unto him all sick people that were taken with diverse diseases and torments, and those which were possessed with what? Devils. Now, do you notice anything odd? He's out there, and there's other. He's casting out devils. You know what's really odd about that? Where do these guys come from? What are they? Why are they there? And what are they doing? The New Testament never tells you. Jesus, here's my point. These devils are at home. This is their home. These devils are free to conduct the business activities that they are assigned to by their commander-in-chief, the devil himself. This is Galilee of the Gentiles. So what's fascinating when you read a passage like he's casting out devils, it's like, wait a minute, wait, where did this come from? The assumption is you should know something about these entities that are at home in God's ultimate landmass. And now you understand historically, God covenanted and promised to Abraham, this is my, there are three issues in the Bible regarding God and the nation of Israel. Number one, my land. Number two, my city, Jerusalem. Number three, my people, the nation of Israel. That is the dominant theme in Scripture, okay? My land, my city, my people. Why are there, and remember that one guy, Jesus asked, what's your name? That's interesting. You know, you just study. Again, Jesus doesn't say anything about the disciples. Why didn't they say, where are they from? What are they doing here? Why are they here? Jesus, he refers to them. He talks about the strong man's house and so forth. But anyway, the Lord Jesus, he starts conversing. He says, what's your name? And remember what the name was? Legion, for we are many. Why are they there? Belongs to us. Galilee of the Gentiles, okay? So when we start looking at the, so here's my point. Why does she see gods ascending out of the earth? Why is Jesus out here? Now, by the way, he's ministering just north of Endor. You can take a Bible atlas, Zebulun and Naphtali. That borders the just north of Endor, okay? Jesus is casting these devils out. I'm getting them out. I'm cleaning the land. That explains, by the way, there are some prophecies regarding the ministry of Messiah. If you go to Zechariah chapter 13, what I'm getting at is, why does this woman have the ability to contact fallen angels, familiar spirits? Because she's living in their backyard. Zechariah chapter 13. Notice there, this is a prophecy, verse 2. Zechariah 13, verse 2. And it shall come to pass in that day, saith the Lord of hosts, that I will cut off the names of the idols out of the land, and they shall no more be remembered. And also I will cause the prophets and the unclean spirit to pass out of the land. What's Jesus doing during the course of his messianic ministry, his earthly ministry? He's cleaning the land. And well, not tonight, but idols are mementos. Idols are a physical object, aid to worship, where a fallen angel is able to make contact with the physical realm. That's why God prohibited idols. And there's a correlation between the gods, devils, and idols. Okay? There's an intimate correlation between the three. So let's go to Joshua. Let's go talk about Endor again. And we've only got 10 minutes, so that's okay. Tonight, we're just looking at the area in which we find this activity. These gods, which are familiar spirits. These are fallen entities. And we go to Joshua chapter 17. And notice Joshua. Now, you remember what happens in Joshua, right? God leads Israel, the second Israel. Okay, remember the first generation? They all died off, right? Because of unbelief. So God, that's a type, by the way, of the remnant, okay, new Israel, the true Israel of God. So what does God do? The first generation, you're dead, okay? Remember, they got to get rebaptized, as it were. They got to cross the Jordan River again. And so in the book of Joshua, you have God that leads the nation into the promised land, and they're wiping all these Gentiles out. God says, we're getting rid of these guys, okay? Notice, for example, Joshua chapter 17. After the conquest of this area, the promised land, they start dividing the land by lots. Remember, there were 12 tribes. So each tribe was given an inheritance. There were 12 lots of land, okay? With that, Joshua chapter 17, verse 11. Verse 11, and Manasseh had in Issachar and in Asher, Bethshean and her towns, and Eblaim and her towns, and the inhabitants of Dor and her towns, and the inhabitants of Endor and her towns, and the inhabitants of Taanach and her towns, and the inhabitants of Megiddo. Does Megiddo remind you? You know what ultimately is going to happen in the book of Revelation? Megiddo, Gog and Magog, and there's a whole bunch of things there. Now look at verse 12. Yet the children of Manasseh could not drive out the inhabitants of those cities, but the Canaanites would dwell in that land. Do you see a problem there? God told Israel, you evict them all. You get them out of the land. did Manasseh, and by the way, Manasseh, his lot of inheritance included Endor, Gilboa, and Shunem. Galilee of the Gentiles, the northern part of this territory that Matthew says darkness. And what's Jesus doing in his ministry? Getting rid of all of these devils. And Matthew never tells you where these guys even came from, why they're there, and what they're doing. The assumption is, don't you already know what's going on? So we already have a problem. What happened as a result of allowing the Canaanites and then ultimately the Hittites? What happened when this tribe allowed these idol-worshipping pagans to inhabit the land? Did Israel convert the pagans over to Judaism? Or did the Israelites convert to Baal worship ultimately? You see what's beginning to happen here? The seeds of rebellion have now been planted. But significantly, Endor is named, okay? Now, keep in mind, we're going to fast forward a little bit in history. Go to Psalms chapter 106. So, failing to evict, failing to destroy, failing to get rid of the Gentile nations and influences in the promised land resulted in Israel beginning to adopt the pagan religious practices, sadly, including the very things God strictly prohibited. For example, look there at Psalms chapter 106. Psalms chapter 106. And if we begin reading at verse 33, Psalms 106, verse 33, because they provoked his spirit so that he spake unadvisedly with his lips. They did not destroy the nations. That's a big problem. Concerning whom the Lord commanded them, but were mingled among the heathen and learned their works, and they served their idols, which were a snare unto them. Yea, they sacrificed their sons and their daughters unto who? Devils. Are devils real spiritual entities? Absolutely. What's Jesus doing? I'm getting rid of these creatures. They don't belong in my land. But they're at home, because Israel, by default, allowed them to stay. And so instead of Israel being the crowning diadem, influencing the Gentiles and winning them over to the... Guess what? The reverse happened. Verse 37, yea, they sacrificed their sons and their daughters unto devils. Those are gods, by the way, according to Paul. In 1 Corinthians chapter 8, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, Paul says, yeah, we know there are many gods. And Paul actually makes the connection between small g gods and devils. Okay. Anyway, verse 38, and shed innocent blood, even the blood of their sons and of their daughters, whom they sacrificed unto the idols of Canaan. And the land was polluted with what? Blood. You see the land issue? That land. And what did that woman see? God's ascending where? Out of the land. There's a proliferation of devils, small g gods, that are there. She is seeing it. Now, she acts as though when she saw Samuel, she screamed. She acts as though she wasn't, you know, necessarily used to what's going on. But it doesn't say she screamed when she saw the gods. Isn't that interesting? She screamed when she saw Samuel. That was unexpected. The small g gods? Not so much, maybe. Go over to Deuteronomy. Go to Deuteronomy. Let's go. We're just two, three more verses, and then we're going to finish up here, right? Deuteronomy. And notice there at verse 18, Deuteronomy chapter 18, okay? And again, not because it's not possible, but because it is possible. Deuteronomy chapter 18, and notice there at verse 9. Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 9. When thou art come into the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, thou shalt not learn to do after the abominations of those nations. There shall not be found among you any one that maketh his son or his daughter to pass through the fire, or that uses divination, or an observer of times, or an enchanter, or a witch, or a charmer, or a consulter with familiar spirits, or a wizard, or a necromancer. For all that do these things are an abomination unto the Lord, and because of these abominations the Lord thy God doth drive them out from before thee. If you want to read a sad, disturbing account of Israel's history, read Isaiah chapter 57. We're not going there. Isaiah chapter 57 describes Israel's activity in this region. How do you sacrifice your child? How do you cause them to pass through the fire? Now, two more verses. Go to Psalms chapter 83. Let's, again, another verse that makes reference to Endor. And what all we're doing, all we've done tonight is, I hope, demonstrated, it is a hotbed of fallen angel activity. Psalms chapter 83, and then we're going to be comparing it with Judges chapter 5, okay? Psalms 83, and then Judges chapter 5. Now, we'll read Psalms 83 first, okay? And let me get away. Somebody moved my book of Judges. There it is. Judges chapter 5. Now let's read Psalms 83. If you're not familiar with Psalms chapter 83, what we have here is a list of the 10 future nations that are going to join forces together, not in a happy, harmonious amalgamation, but they're going to join forces as a confederacy, right? And what is the goal of the 10 nations in the future? Destroy Israel. You talk about full war, full extermination. Just keep that in mind. Psalms chapter 83, verse 3, they have taken crafty counsel against thy people and have consulted against thy hidden ones. The book of Revelation, that's the little flock. That's the remnant. They have said, come and let us cut them off from being a nation, that the name of Israel may be no more in remembrance. For they have consulted together with one consent. They are confederate against thee. The tabernacles of Edom. You know what the tabernacles of Edom are? Those are the houses of Baal in 1 Kings. And the Ishmaelites of Moab, and the Hagarenes, Gebal, and Ammon, and Amalek, the Philistines, with the inhabitants of Tyre. Asher also is joined with them. They have holpen the children of Lot, Selah. You have identified the 10-nation confederacy, okay? And their blood desire, they're consumed with the destruction of Israel. What we know about these 10 nations in the future under the operational control of the Antichrist, these are no ordinary kings. They are demonic in nature. Daniel chapter 2 describes these 10 kings, and they are part iron and part clay. You know what the iron represents? They're not your typical ordinary politician like Joe Biden or Donald Trump. These guys are satanic. They're demonic, for lack of a better word. So keep reading. Verse 9. What is the cry of the remnant? Do unto them, those 10 nations that are satanically inspired, do unto them as unto the Midianites, as to Sisera, as to Jabin, at the brook of Kishon, which perished at where? Endor. Wait a minute. The appeal to God is, remember what you did back in the past at Endor? repeated out there in the future. The thing we have to recognize is, in the future, you have direct satanic influence by the man of sin, the son of perdition, this 10 nation, these 10 kings that are part iron. They're demonic in spirit. And the appeal is, destroy those devils just like you destroyed something in Endor. What happened in Endor? Now, you keep your finger here, because we're going to have to notice, go to Judges chapter 5, and look there at verse 19. Judges chapter 5, and notice there at verse 19. The kings came and fought, then fought the kings of Canaan in Taanach by the waters of Megiddo. Now, okay, that is the area that was given to Manasseh, and he didn't get rid of these guys, okay? Verse 19, they took no gain of money. Verse 20, they fought from heaven. The stars in their courses fought against Sisera. The river of Kishon swept them away. That ancient river, the river Kishon. Oh, my soul, thou hast trodden down strength. The writer in Psalms chapter 83 is appealing to verses 19 through verse 21. Because the writer in Psalms 83, he's talking about Sisera. He's talking about Kishon. What we notice in Judges chapter 5 is there is angelic activity described in verse 20. They fought from where? Heaven. The stars in their courses fought against Sisera. You know what stars represent in the Bible? They're angels. There is a correlation between the activities, the battles taking place on earth, and the battles that are taking in the invisible realm. Now, I'm going to just close here. There is an impending battle going to take place here. Israel is on the verge of war with the Philistines in the backyard of the pagan Gentile gods. And what's going on is there's this satanic activity taking place here. This woman is tapping into something out there. Here we read about, by the way, and I know, remember in Daniel chapter 10, when God dispatched Gabriel to communicate to Daniel. And remember what Gabriel said to Daniel? He apologized to Daniel. It took me 21 days to get here. And you know why it took me 21 days? The prince of Persia, he prevented me. Was he talking about the literal, physical human being, the prince of Persia? Or was he talking about an angelic? But why did they share the same name? And then remember what he says. Listen, when I got to go back, I got to go back. And then, of course, Michael, Archangel Michael, he intervenes. Anyway, then he says, I got to go back, and now I got to deal with the prince of Persia and the prince of Grecia. Is he talking about the literal human prince? He's talking about an angel, a fallen angel. Why are they sharing the same names as the earthly nations? There's a correlation between the two. We'll stop. There is an impending battle taking place. There are gods that are busy at work because their desire is to destroy the nation of Israel. In Psalms chapter 83, those 10 nations, satanically inspired, there's going to be tremendous devil activity. They're trying to destroy the nation of Israel. In Judges chapter 5, guess what these Canaanites and pagans are trying to do? Destroy the nation of Israel. Behind the visible armies are the invisible armies, okay? So we're going to stop. We didn't even talk about what happens between Samuel and God and Saul and all of that kind of stuff. If at the outset we recognize that, hey, we ought not be shocked at what's going on in this particular area, considering the impending battle, and now all of a sudden you've got gods that are operating out there, okay? God, and I'll just tell you this, God is going to call Samuel up. I take it literally. For the reason of communicating to Samuel that Israel, Samuel along with apostate Israel, they're the true necromancers. They're the true familiar spirits who are now taking on an alter identity and an alter persona. You know who's really acting like the familiar spirit? Saul. So God says, you're going to die. Now, Samuel, I understand that. Samuel says to Saul, you're going to die. By the way, the witch gets to live. And you read the end of chapter 28. The witch serves the king of Israel. The idol-worshipping pagan Gentile is serving and comforting Saul, the king of Israel. That's a type of the future glory. When God, when Jesus Christ establishes that literal physical kingdom on planet Earth, you know what the Gentiles are joyfully going to do? Serve the nation of Israel. Anyway, there's a bunch of typology. Thank you for your patience. We'll just quit. Father, again, we thank you for your grace, for your love. We thank you for your word. And as always, may we continue to learn and have greater insight regarding who you are and what it is you're doing. And we thank you for it all in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks again for your patience.